grounded on its revolutionary Game Boy console with Zelda Link's Awakening. Link's Awakening featured much more of its predecessor gameplay and introduced a trading game with hilarious items such as Yoshi dolls, bananas, dog food, and more. Link also saw a reincarnation in 98 with Game Boy Color and the DX version. In between the long years of 93 to 98, Link did see one game in Japan in 97 called BS Zelda 1 on the Super Famicom. But with the release of Nintendo 64, this game never saw stateside waters. And in 1998, out of Miyamoto's brain, came the best Zelda game ever, with Ocarina of Time. Selling more than 7 million copies and still counting, in my opinion, Ocarina of Time was what I would envision as Miyamoto's greatest interpretation of where he grew up. The game was released in limited gold cartridges and received perfect scores in almost every review. Some called Ocarina the best game in the Zelda series ever. Nintendo later followed up with Majora's Mask in 2000. The game would see popularity with diehard fans of the series while still a fantastic game in its own rights. In 2001, Capcom took the Zelda reins and developed two synchronistic Game Boy Color games, The Legend of Zelda, Oracle of Ages, and The Legend of Zelda, Oracle of Seasons. Although not developed in-house, both games were surprisingly fantastic, and using Game Boy Link, gamers could unlock secrets in both. In 2003, the GameCube was released, and it was time for Zelda to take another stab on a new console. This time, Miyamoto felt his longtime vision for the series of being more cartoonish would finally thrive on the new platform. Thus, The Legend of Zelda, The Wind Waker was born. For those lucky enough to pre-order the game, a bonus disc was included featuring The Legend of Zelda, Ocarina of Time, and Master Quest. Master Quest was an additional add-on for Ocarina of Time not released in the US that featured more advanced dungeons. Cel-shading technology was used in The Wind Waker to fully recognize Shigeru's vision. However, while the game reached satisfactory sales and encompassed innovative gameplay, gamers did not get on board with the new cartoonish look. In late 2003, a special collector's edition disc was released for the GameCube that included many of the classic NES, SNES Zelda games, as well as a demo for the new Wind Waker to try and boost excitability. The series then saw re-release on two older NES titles on the new Game Boy Advance in 2004 with The Legend of Zelda: Four Swords, featuring exclusive link capabilities between the Game Boy Advance and GameCube. In 2005, we saw the last of Link's adventures to be released with the GameCube Advance title, The Legend of Zelda, The Minish Cap. Now it's 2006, and Miyamoto is at it again with his childhood fantasies in an upcoming DS title called Phantom Hourglass, and a new GameCube and Wii title called The Legend of Zelda, Twilight Princess, previewed earlier. Shigeru Miyamoto will be remembered in history as a legend. The Legend of Zelda will be remembered by history as one of the greatest series of all time, neither of which are ready for the history books just yet.
We'll be right back.
come to the end of the road on our official first episode. I'd like to thank our crew behind the scenes, Oofta Entertainment Company, and TVC TV. You can find links and information on each episode on our site at digitizedontv.com. I'd also like to thank my co-host, Justin. I'm Jeremy. Thanks for watching Digitized. We'll see you next time.